She is now the professor in charge of the Indian Astronomical Observatory at Hanle on the Himalayas in Ladakh. And now she is also the principal investigator of the scientific team which is representing IAA in this prestigious 30-meter telescope, about which we are going to hear from her now the details. She is also a recipient of several awards, one of them being the Young Scientist Award, C.V. Raman Award in 2001.
It's a pleasure to be here and give this talk on the 30-meter telescope, of which India is a partner. My association with Sharaja goes a long way since the time I joined the Indian Institute of Astrophysics as a student, and she was a faculty there. So it's indeed a great pleasure to be here at the planetarium during her tenure as director. So before I actually go on to talking about the 30-meter telescope, let me give a brief introduction on you know, what the requirements of an astronomer are as regards telescopes, and why a 30-meter telescope. And then I'll also talk about what India is actually doing in this project. So this is the content of my talk today. As I said, I'll start with a brief introduction and very quickly describe the giant segmented telescopes of the future, and then go on to the 30-meter telescope project itself and what India is doing in this project. So basically, I mean, what is astronomy? I mean, astronomy is the science of the universe, and it encompasses not just physics, but also mathematics, astrochemistry, biology. So it's like a mother of all sciences in a certain sense. Now, to study the objects, we need data, obviously. So in what form do we get the astronomical data? It's basically the electromagnetic radiation from these objects that we detect and we analyze to understand these objects. And these electromagnetic radiation are detected through the use of telescopes. In addition to electromagnetic radiation, the celestial sources also emit in the cosmic rays. They also emit neutrinos and antineutrinos, gravitational waves. And we can also understand about the celestial objects through the meteorites by the analysis of the meteoritic material. And of late, you know, one can explore the solar system by the use of satellites. And recently, you would have heard about a satellite flying past Pluto and taking the images and revealing a lot of information about this most distant planet in our own solar system, and no longer termed as a planet, but nonetheless, you know, one of the outer solar system objects. So what is an astronomical observatory? And obviously, an astronomical observatory needs to consist of the telescope to collect the radiation. In the radio region, one uses the reflectors and antennae to collect the radiation. In the optical and ultraviolet and infrared, one uses polished reflectors. The X-rays and gamma rays require special mirrors to be able to collect the radiation. And in the high energy gamma rays, if you're looking at an observatory on the ground, it's a Cherenkov radiation from the atmosphere which is used to study these high energy gamma rays. Now, at the back end of the telescopes, normally one has instruments, which are the main systems which analyze the radiation. Essentially, one detects the intensity or the polarization of the electromagnetic radiation that is received. Or one also gets a spectrum of the objects to analyze. And finally, you need something to record this analyzed radiation, and for that one uses detectors. In the ancient times, it was our eye which was the detector, but nowadays we have electronic devices doing this job for us. Now, most observatories, or almost all of them, are located at remote sites and at high altitudes. Now, why do we need them to be located at remote site and at high altitude? Basically, because as I said, I mean, we are looking at the light, and because you're looking at electromagnetic radiation coming from these sources, you need to be at a location where you avoid man-made interference, and you also need to be at a location to reduce the atmospheric effects. Now, man-made interference, as you know, is the light that we use, just, you know, throws up the light to the sky and then brightens up the sky, so you cannot observe the celestial objects. And the other man-made interference is in the radio region, especially nowadays with all these mobile telephones. It's really eating into the radio region from which you get radiation from the celestial objects. So as I said earlier, this is a map of the night sky emission of the world, and as you can see in the highly dense, densely populated regions, you find there's a lot of light coming, and also in the highly advanced regions, the light pollution is extremely high. So this is obviously, this tells you that we need to go to a remote location where the light pollution is not very high. And also, why do you need a high altitude site? Because the Earth's atmosphere absorbs light in certain bands, and here is a picture of the Earth's atmosphere and its absorption. As you can see, there are very few regions where the absorption is on the lower side. Now, this is a visible range where the Earth's atmosphere absorbs the least, and hence there are a lot of optical telescopes which are ground based. And again, here in the radio region, the absorption is much lower. This another window here in the infrared. Now, the X-rays and the gamma rays are more or less absorbed by the Earth's atmosphere, and hence you normally go to the space to study in these regions, as also with the ultraviolet region. So, if you're looking at the ground-based observatories, then one needs to go to high altitude, basically because when you go to the higher altitude, the transmission of the atmosphere improves with altitude. So as you go higher, the atmospheric layer, which is absorbing, gets reduced, so you get a better transmission at higher altitudes. And the scatter of the night sky is also somewhat less. So hence, we need a remote high altitude site with low atmospheric turbulence, as well as with the least interference, to establish an astronomical observatory. So if you look at the history of optical astronomy and the telescopes, the scientific advancement is directly correlated with the technological progress in the telescopes. And there has been an increase in the light gathering power and resolving power over the several decades since the telescope came into being and it was used for astronomical purposes. And also the technologies such as active and adaptive optics have also helped a great deal in the observations. And methods such as interferometry, which is basically combining the light from two or more telescopes, this helps in giving very sharp images, which again helps us in resolving the celestial objects much better. So from the time Galileo first used the telescope in 1600 to now, all the way from a very small telescope of about 3 inches, we have now currently at 10 to 11 meter size telescopes. And in the future, in the next decade or so, there will be 20 to 40 meter telescopes available. So this talk is all about these large telescopes. So what are optical telescopes? I mean, these are nothing but instruments which gather and focus light from the celestial objects. They help in magnifying the angular size of these different distant objects. And also, the larger the telescope, the better is the light gathering power. And not only that, the larger the telescope, the better is the resolving power of the telescope. Now, what is meant by resolving power is how clearly you can distinguish two neighboring objects. Like, for example, if you're on a highway and there's a truck coming from the opposite direction, at a very large distance, you will see the light. You'll probably see just one light. You do not know what that object is, but you know it's an object coming towards you and you're seeing a light. As it approaches closer, you begin to, you know, resolve it and you say, ah, this is an, you know, a vehicle which has two lights. So it's a four-wheeler. As it comes even closer, you say, ah, now I can see at what height I can see the lights. So it's not a car. It's something which is, you know, elevated. And even closer, you say, okay, this is a truck. So this is basically the eye has a certain resolution, and the resolving power of the eye is based on the distance at which the object is, right? So likewise, how well a telescope can resolve. Now all these celestial objects are more or less, we can consider them as being at infinity, right? So how well a telescope can resolve depends upon the diameter of the telescope. That is the primary mirror. So as this equation shows here, the resolving power is better the larger the diameter. So it is inversely proportional to the diameter. So the resolving power is better with the as an inverse of the diameter. Now telescopes can be of two kinds, one consisting of lenses and another consisting of mirrors. So a combination of lenses are called the refracting telescopes, and a combination of mirrors are called the reflecting telescope. All modern day telescopes are reflecting telescopes. So to give an example of the telescope and its optical layout. Now this is the ray coming from a celestial object. It is coming from infinity, and hence you are getting parallel rays. You have the primary mirror, which is the main light collecting optical element here. And the focus of the primary mirror is here. Now what is normally done in the telescopes is you place another mirror which is just before the prime focus in the path of the reflecting ray, and you reflect these rays back to a location behind the primary mirror. And this is called the Cassegrain focus. Now why is this done? Basically because it helps you attach instruments behind on the tube of the telescope, and to a certain extent you can have, you know, larger and slightly heavier instruments as compared to having an instrument here, because as you can see, if you have a large instrument here, it will start obstructing the light you're getting from these celestial objects, which is something you don't want to do. So this is what is done in most modern telescopes. The instrument is located at the Cassegrain focus. Now such an optical device has aberrations, that is, it has some distortions in the image, and some of these are what are termed as a coma or the spherical aberration. Now to get rid of these aberrations, what is done is the shape of this primary mirror and the shape of the secondary mirror is not a normal sphere, but you have a hyperboloid primary and also a hyperboloid secondary, which reduces the spherical aberration and the coma. Now another type of telescope is with what is called as the Nasmyth telescope, where instead of the light being taken behind the primary mirror, you have a third mirror, which is a flat mirror, which is kept at 45 degrees and which will deflect it to a focus by the side of the tube, and this focus is called the Nasmyth focus. Now why is this done? You will very soon understand when we go to the 30 meter telescope design itself. I'll explain at that time why this is a very useful focus and why this is what is being chosen these days. So now we have the telescope, and you know, let us assume we have a fairly decent size for the diameter. I now say that I can resolve stars, but then there is another thing which comes into play. I talked about the atmospheric turbulence earlier. Now, what does this atmospheric turbulence do? We know that since these objects are at infinity, the stars are at infinity, they appear like point sources. So in principle, we should be, when we record the images of the star field, it should be point sources. But then they are not. We find that they have a finite diameter. Now, why is this happening? This is happening basically because of the Earth's atmosphere. The Earth's atmosphere has turbulences, and these turbulences spread the light which is coming from the star by a small extent, because of which a point source as recorded on a detector has a finite dimension. And depending upon the amount of the turbulence, the width changes. So an extremely good site is one where the turbulence is the least and you get as sharp an image as possible. But even amongst the best site, you cannot get the size to be better than something like 0.5 arcsecond. Whereas if you look at a large size telescope, for example, even a 2-meter class telescope, the diffraction limit says you should be able to resolve at two objects which are separated by 0.3 arcsecond. Now let me say I put my telescope at the best site that I can find in the world, which is, for example, in the Chilean mountains in the Atacama Desert. Even there, the seeing is like 0.5 arcseconds at best, and even that for a small fraction of time. So even with a 2-meter class telescope, I'm not able to resolve objects. So that is the reason why the HST was flown into space. And with the HST, you can get diffraction limited images. But we cannot keep, you know, sending telescopes into space every now and then, because it's a very costly affair. So you need telescopes at the ground. But then you also need to beat the effect of the atmosphere. So how is it done? It is done by a method called the adaptive optics. So the main goal of the adaptive optics is to measure the error caused by the spread caused by the atmospheric turbulence and correct for these errors. So what is done here is that you have sensors, what are called as the wavefront sensors. Now these wavefront sensors provide a measure of the image degradation caused by the Earth's turbulent atmosphere, and they are corrected for. Now you can measure the wavefront errors by using a reference star. Now this reference star can be an actual celestial object, or you create artificial stars by shining a laser. A couple of lasers you shine to the upper atmosphere and you create artificial stars, which will then give you a measure of the turbulence. And that is corrected for with technique called the adaptive optics. So what are the main instruments that are there at the back end of the telescope, and either the Cassegrain focus or the Nasmyth focus? There are several variants of some generic instruments that I have mentioned here. One is you can do a direct image of the field, which is essentially for estimating the magnitudes and the morphology of this object. The other is you can have spectrometers where basically you have gratings in this instrument which disperse the light and give you a spectrum. Getting the spectrum is very useful because that can help us analyze and understand the physical conditions of these celestial objects. And then you can also have more specialized instruments called the polarimeters to study the polarization of the light, or the interferometers, which will help us give high spatial resolution, and various such instruments. And the variants of these generic instruments are generally used in all telescopes. So I give here an example of a spectrometer. Basically, what we do is a light coming from the telescope is focused, and at the focus there is a slit which helps in taking the light onto another optical element, which is generally a collimator. So what the collimator does is, the collimator is used such that its focal length is it's kept at a distance corresponding exactly to the focal length of this mirror, and hence because of that, if you remember your optics, it produces the reflected rays from this mirror are parallel rays, and these parallel rays go on to the grating which disperses the light, and this dispersed light falls on to another optical element or a chain of optical elements which serve as the camera, and finally it is brought into focus onto the detector. And how well the gratings can resolve the light into different wavelength regions is what is termed as the spectral resolution. And this depends upon the number of grooves which are there in the grating. So what is a CCD detector? I mean, all of you would be aware of detectors like the CCD or the CMOS detectors. I mean, these are the detectors which are used in all the digital cameras and even on all the smartphones. Now, these detectors were first used for defense, and then the astronomers were the first, you know, use of civilian use for of these detectors. And even now they use it. Primarily, these are extremely good detectors for observing faint sources. They have good light gathering, light detection power. So this is essentially a silicon device which has a tight array of pixels, and these pixels act as small buckets for collecting the light. And basically there is a potential well which is created in these pixels, and then the photons which strike the silicon wafer, they generate electrons which are stored in these pixels, and eventually these electrons are transferred and read out. So what we get from the detector is essentially electrical signals which are then converted back into what we see as images. So now I have given you some brief overview of the telescope and, you know, some instruments that we use, and also the kind of detectors that are used. Now this is all, I should mention to you, this is all what is used in the optical region, the ground-based telescopes in the optical region. So now let me go on to the future. Okay, in the next few years, and in under a decade or so, we'll be having what are called as a giant segmented telescopes, and there are going to be three such telescopes. These are the segmented mirror telescopes of the future. Now, what do you mean by segmented mirror? Now, in these telescopes, the primary is not a single mirror, but it consists of several mirrors. So there are several segments, and all these segments together behave as a single mirror. Okay? So the three such telescopes of the future are the Giant Magellan Telescope, the European Extremely Large Telescope, and the 30-meter telescope. The Giant Magellan Telescope, it consists of seven mirrors, each of 8-meter diameter, and this is the configuration. The total diameter is 25 meters, but the effective diameter, that is the light gathering diameter, is 22 meters. The ELT and the TMT, they consist of several small segments, each of hexagonal shape, and the effective diameter of the ELT is about 39 meters, and that of the TMT is about 30 meters. So each segment is a hexagon of a diagonal size of about 1.45 meters. So this essentially means that to have an effective size of 30 meters, one requires about 492 segments. And in the case of ELT, one requires almost 800 segments to make up 39 meters. So these are the three large telescopes which will be coming to use in the mid 2020s. So let me go on to the 30 meter telescope itself, which is of prime interest to us since India is a partner in this. Now the 30 meter telescope project, this is an international partnership, and it will be operated by the TMT International Observatory, which is a non-profit organization. This was formally formed in 2014, although it existed, the partnership existed earlier, but not in the form of the TIO. So it was formed in 2014 as the legal entity by which the members will construct and operate the observatory. And it was on May 6th that the financial authorities of Caltech, China, Japan, the universities of California signed the company formation and the detailed contribution agreement documents. India joined in September 2014, and the final signing was done in December. Canada joined this year in April. So these are the partners of this project. So as you can see, it's an international partner. In fact, the other two projects are also international partnerships, and you know, projects of this kind cannot be done by any single organization, or for that matter even any single country. They necessarily have to be international partners. Now, where is the TMT going to be located? It's going to be located on the mountain of Mauna Kea in Hawaii. Why was this site chosen? Because it's one of the best sites that we can get for doing astronomy. It already has several telescopes, and in fact this site has four of the currently available large telescopes: the two Keck telescopes, the 8-meter Subaru telescope, and the 8-meter Gemini North telescopes. All of them are located on the mountaintop of Mauna Kea. So here are just a few statistics. It has a large number of clear nights. More than 76% of the time it is clear. It is an extremely dry site and at a high altitude of 4000 meters. And also it is a fairly cold site, which essentially means that the transmission in the infrared is much higher, and so it is a good site to do infrared astronomy. Now here are the seeing statistics, which is essentially a measure of the turbulence of the Earth's atmosphere. As we can see, for a good fraction of the time, the seeing is sub-arc second. So even in terms of the Earth's turbulence, it is one of the sites which have extremely low turbulence. So in short, it is a fairly good site, a site where one can locate a telescope of this class. And quite interestingly, it is centrally, more or less centrally located as far as all the partners are concerned. So the TMT is a Pacific Rim partnership centered around Hawaii. As you can see, here is where Mauna Kea is, and you have the Canadian partners, the US partners, China, Japan and India. So why 30 meters? Why was this particularly chosen? Now, when one is building a telescope, it is the diameter of the primary mirror which is the key in your design choice. Not only does it drive your science requirements, but it also drives the size and complexity of the entire observatory. All the other systems that are required in the observatory. So this is a key parameter in the design choice. And as I've said earlier, it is the observations are heavily limited by the atmospheric turbulence, and so I mentioned that the adaptive optics is what helps us. remove the effects of the turbulence. So a detailed study of the analysis of the adaptive optics technology that is available and what will be available to the project over the next few years. Now, weighing that with respect to the science goals that one wants to achieve with this telescope, and of course also weighing with the cost factors, everything put together, it was found that a diameter of 30 meters is where, you know, it was an attractive diameter which could not only meet the science goals but could also meet the financial goals. Now let me come to some features of the telescope itself. If you compare it with the largest telescopes that are currently available, it has, you know, typically 10 times the light collecting area as compared to an 8 to 10 meter class telescope. And if you were to compare it with the Hubble Space Telescope, it has 10 times the resolution of the Hubble Space Telescope. And it will have at least 5 times the resolution of the future James Webb Space Telescope, which is a 6 meter telescope which will be flown sometime again in the early 2020s. If you look at the sensitivity itself, it has 100 times the sensitivity of the currently large telescopes. The telescope will have a high performance adaptive optics system. So in principle, one can obtain images which are very close to the diffraction limit of a 30 meter telescope. So what this means is that one will be able to resolve objects which are as small as 25 kilometer on this size, 25 kilometer in size on Jupiter's surface. Okay. So it will have such an extremely good resolution. So which means that without having to send a satellite all the way to Jupiter, you would still be able to do extremely good, you know, studies of the solar system objects also from ground-based telescopes. So potentially TMT will be 14 times to 400 times more sensitive than the current available large telescopes. And because it is at least 14 times more efficient, 20 nights on the telescope, on the 30 meter telescope, is equivalent to having about 280 nights on the current 8 to 10 meter class telescopes. Now, why 20 nights is what I have chosen? Because that is the amount of nights that India would get on this telescope at the 10% partnership level that we are in this project. Okay. So, if we had to have a 10 meter telescope in the country, the amount of data that one could get in 280 nights, almost 300 nights, that is over a whole year, you can get that amount of data on, you know, just about 20 nights on such a large telescope. And not to forget that the quality itself is going to be much better. You will be going to much fainter limits and you will be getting much higher resolution than what you can get with a 10 meter telescope. So this is just an illustration of the high resolution and its comparison with what you can get with these space telescopes, which are not affected by the Earth's atmosphere. So this brings us to the science. Now, what is the science that we hope to do with this telescope? What are the big questions? And quite naturally, everyone is interested in the nature and the composition of the universe itself. When did the first galaxies form and how did they evolve to be what they are today? We all know that all galaxies contain black holes in the center. So what is the relationship between these black holes and the rest of the galaxy? Like, how does the mass of the black hole affect the evolution of the galaxies and the other properties of the galaxy? How do stars and planets form? And coming closer, this is what we would be interested in. What is the nature of extrasolar planets that one has been finding off late, quite a few of them? And of course, most important, is there life elsewhere in the universe? So, just to go a little more in detail in some of these interesting science cases, one interesting aspect is, which will help us understand the composition of the universe, is to understand the dark energy. You would have all read about the fact that the universe is expanding, and then this expansion is actually increasing, the rate of expansion is increasing. And a few years back, in fact, two groups which studied this were awarded the Nobel Prize. They used the objects called the supernovae to arrive at this result. So this is what is called as the acceleration of the universe, and the acceleration is believed to be caused by a repulsive force which is called the dark energy. So understanding the origin and nature of this dark energy is central to the understanding of the universe itself. And this study requires probing the universe to the farthest corners. Okay, so how do you probe the universe to the farthest corners? That's primarily by looking, observing bright objects which are more distant. Okay, so if you want to observe, I mean, we all know that as an object moves away, although its intrinsic brightness is the same, as it is moving away, the amount of light you receive keeps fading, so it gets fainter and fainter. So you need large telescopes to be able to get the light from the most distant objects. Okay? So the larger the telescope, the farther you can reach out. And the 30 meter telescope will enable us to study these supernovae of type 1A, which are the primary cosmological probes, to redshifts, which are much beyond what led to the discovery of the acceleration of the universe. And of course, the study of the most distant galaxies. Now, not only does the light from these objects fade as you move away, the size also keeps getting smaller. Okay, so, and it's like the example I gave you of the truck. From a very large distance, you can't really make out it's a truck. Only when it comes closer, you can make out it's a truck. Likewise, these galaxies, as the more distant they are, you can't really make out their galaxies. You don't know the morphology of these galaxies. That is basically, you know, what size they are and what shape they have. Okay. So the TMT with the adaptive optics will help us not only gather more light but also resolve these optics, as an you know, by which you can not only know the where these objects are and you know, get the light from them for analysis. We can also understand the size and the shape of these objects. And of course, with spectroscopic analysis, you can even understand the physical condition in these objects. Another interesting area is to study what the objects which are called the first stars. That is, these are the stars which are supposed to have been formed very early in the universe, and these are stars which are sort of uncontaminated with the very basic elements like hydrogen and helium in them. The nuclear processes had not gone beyond that to form other elements, so they are uncontaminated, the very early phase stars. But TMT, spectroscopy with the TMT will enable the first direct detection of helium in these first stars and help us understand the nature of these objects. And of course, our own galaxy, one is interested in understanding our own galaxy. In the center of our galaxy lies a supermassive black hole. Now, what is this supermassive black hole? What is the nature of this? We still don't have a very clear understanding. With the high resolution that the TMT will provide us, one can actually be able to study the stellar motion of the stars around this black hole, and this will you know, by understanding the orbital motion of the stars around the black hole, one can actually indirectly get information about the mass of the black hole. So it will help us understand the black hole in our own galaxy. And the other interesting aspect of the high spatial resolution that the telescope can give will actually help us study the disks around stars where the planets are supposed to be formed. in much greater detail. So the TMT can probe the inner planet forming region around the stars, and of course the extrasolar planets themselves. The current facilities which are detecting a whole lot of planets are mostly concentrated in those objects which are relatively larger in size. What is more interesting for us is the study of objects which have the size similar to that of Earth. That is what we would be interested in. And how will the TMT help us in that? Basically, because of the high angular resolution, it will be able to resolve and directly image planets in the habitable zone. Now, what is the habitable zone? The habitable zone is the distance from the central star, which is optimal for the temperature where water can exist as a liquid and the planet itself is rocky. Now, we believe that a planet which is rocky and which has water in the liquid form is best suited for life as we know on Earth. And not only will it be able to directly image these objects, the sensitivity that TMT will have will also enable spectroscopy of these objects, and from the spectrum one could actually obtain the presence of elements such as oxygen and nitrogen, which are the signatures of life on the planets. And of course, another interesting area is in the follow-up of gravitational wave sources. Now, what are these gravitational waves? These are waves which are released when you have two massive objects merging, like for example a neutron star and a black hole, or two neutron stars which are merging somewhere, you know, in the distant regions in the sky. So when these two objects merge, this binding energy which is released in the form of gravitational waves, these are extremely weak signals. And there are detectors which are such as the LIGO, which is used to detect these gravitational waves. Now, these gravitational waves are not directly detected with a telescope like TMT. So, what is it that the TMT can do for these kind of objects? What the TMT will help us do is be able to identify the optical counterpart of these objects. That is basically the remnant which is formed out of the merger of these massive objects will be emitting in the electromagnetic radiation which can be detected with the TMT, and the analysis of that radiation will help us understand the nature of the objects which gave rise to these gravitational waves. So to summarize what the TMT can do, the high light gathering power and the spatial resolution will essentially revolutionize the studies of in the areas of the characterization of the extrasolar planets, understand the first epoch of star formation in the universe, in the assembly and evolution of galaxies, and finally in the fundamental physics of dark matter and dark energy. So now let us see what the telescope parameters are which will enable us in doing all this fantastic science. The TMT has certain top level requirements which is driven by the science that I mentioned, and some of these are it should have a wide wavelength range all the way from 0.31 to 28 microns. That is, this is at the cutoff at the ultraviolet range. And 28 microns is almost at the cutoff in the infrared range, the cutoff due to the Earth's atmosphere. It will have a field of view which is about 20 arc minutes in diameter, which is extremely large for a telescope of this size. It will be able to observe at various zenith angles all the way down to 65 degrees. And the zenith angle is when you're pointing up towards the top. Zenith angle is zero, and as you're coming down to the horizon, zenith angle increases. So this is almost fairly close to the horizon. Horizon itself is at 90 degrees. So you're at just about, you know, a little over 30 degrees from the horizon. And another most important aspect of this telescope, which is unique to the 30 meter telescope and not available on the other two large telescopes, is that the telescope should be able to slew from any science object to another and initialize the instrument to take an observation within 5 minutes if there is no change of instrument required, and within 10 minutes if there is a change of instrument required. Now, why is this important? This is extremely important because this helps us observe serendipitous discoveries, objects like, for example, the gamma ray bursts, which just happen, and there's no prior knowledge that these objects are going to, go into outburst. And when these objects are discovered, the earlier you catch on and analyze the radiation coming from these objects, the better for the understanding of the nature of these objects. They fade extremely rapidly. Within 24 hours, they fade. So you need to be able to observe these objects almost immediately. And this is where this feature of the 30 meter telescope is extremely useful. Now, when the 30 meter telescope will be in operation, there'll be another facility that will be in operation that is called the LSST, or the Large Synoptic Survey Telescope. Now, this is an 8 meter survey telescope, which means that it's got an extremely large field of view, and it is looking at, it is scanning the sky and looking for new objects in the sky. And typically the LSST will be, discovering thousands of objects in a night. Of course, the TMT cannot and will not be observing all the thousand objects, but will definitely be targeting the most interesting objects from this survey. The system architecture, and this is a telescope which has a Ritchey-Chretien design, which essentially means that the primary is a hyperboloid, the secondary is also a hyperboloid. And it has a tertiary mirror, which is a flat mirror, which directs the light onto these ports, which is the, it has two Nasmyth ports. So if you remember what I mentioned earlier, the Nasmyth focus will bring the light out by the side of the telescope tube, right? So that is what it does. Now, what is the advantage of this is that at these side ports, you can actually have very stable platforms, and because this is not the which enables you to have heavy and instruments, not only heavy instruments, you can have several instruments. So why is that? Basically, because it is not at the back of the telescope, so you don't have to worry too much about how much weight the telescope tube can take and the balancing of the telescope. So in principle, you can have several instruments and also heavy ones. So the design of the observatory is such that you will have all the instruments mounted on these ports, and if you want to observe through any given instrument, all that you need to do is rotate the tertiary so that the light is deflected into the relevant port. Okay? So all the instruments will be available. And in principle, if one wants to observe in different wavelength regions, one can easily do it in a given night. The 5-minute and 10-minute feature comes in several aspects. One is, yes, I mean the tertiary movement, but also the most important movement is the telescope movement itself. See, let us assume that the telescope is looking in this direction of the sky. Okay? Then the information comes that there is a GRB or an unknown transient, which we know will fade very fast, and you need to go to the telescope, and let us say the object is in this direction. So you need to move from here to here, okay? The complete telescope, yes. So the whole thing, the telescope has to move, and if I say that I'm going to observe with the same instrument that was being used earlier, let me assume that, but if it is a spectrograph, for instance, okay? The person who was using it before would have been observing in a certain range of this spectrograph with a particular grating. Now I want in a slightly different range, okay, which means I have to change the grating. So that has to be changed. The telescope has to move to the location, and all the other configuration within the instrument has to be set up to be able to observe my object, which is totally away from the current location. All this has to happen in 5 minutes. So the whole telescope is designed in such a manner that this can happen. So this is a base top level requirement of the telescope. So everything is designed, the electronics, the mechanical aspects, the controls, everything is designed for this to happen. Okay, so this is just to give you an idea of the dimensions. So the base itself is about 36.2, of which the mirror diameter is 30 meters. From the observing floor to the top of the dome is 56 meters. So it's a massive structure. The mount itself, it's an altitude over azimuth design, which is what is generally used in most large telescopes. I think I need not go into greater detail into all this, except to say that, reiterate once again, that the science instruments are mounted on the Nasmyth platforms. Now here is the secondary mirror, which is supported on tripod, and the mirror position itself is stabilized by 6 tension mirrors to the elevation axis. Yeah, the 23 meters to the elevation axis, and the mirror is between 16 and 23 meters. So the total aperture is 30 meters. And as I said earlier, this is a segmented mirror. There are 492 segments. The focal ratio of the primary is F1. It's an extremely fast mirror in that sense. So because it is an F1 primary, the height is, you know, about 50 meters. Had it been a slower beam, then it would have been even higher. Okay. Now each segment is very thin. It's just 45 mm, and there are 13,000 supports totally, support points totally in the entire 30 meter mirror. There are almost 10,000 degrees of freedom totally in M1. It's massive. Total mass is 100 ton. And there are gaps between the segments, which is about 2.5 mm. It's a physical gap. So because of these, there is about just about 0.6% collecting area loss, which is absolutely minimal. Yeah, so and this is typically how it will appear, okay, if you consider these hexagonal mirrors. Now, these are the inter-segment gaps. The primary will have a curvature, right? I mean, it's a meniscus, so it will have a curvature. Now, one has to fit in these segments within that curvature, okay? So, when you design this, so that you want these various segments all the way from the center to the edge of the mirror to all behave like a single 30 meter mirror of a given meniscus, it turns out that one has 82 types. So you essentially end up with 82 different segment types which are located along the diameter of the mirror. So this is the way it goes, right? All the way from here to these different 82 types. Okay. And there are 6 identical sectors. Just go by the symmetry. There are 6 identical sectors of each sector having 82 different types of hexagon. I mean, the symmetry is basically different. That the shape of each hexagon is slightly different. So each hexagon here is not spherical but aspheric in nature. Okay. So when you are actually making these mirrors, it becomes more complicated because of the fact that each segment is aspheric. And the criteria which has been put in, that the inter-segment gap has got to remain constant. Okay. So physically, wherever you are, whether you are at the center or at the edge of your mirror, the inter-segment gap is 2.5 mm. Now, to maintain that, what it means is that the hexagon is not a perfect hexagon, it's not a regular hexagon. So, it is, the dimensions are slightly different. So, which again is, makes the production of each of these segments highly complicated. So, what is important is that whichever direction the telescope is looking in, the telescope has, the primary mirror has to maintain the same shape. Okay? So, that is of prime importance. Otherwise, the objects will no longer, if you are looking at a star, it will no longer remain as a point source. Now, wherever the telescope is looking, if you are observing stars, they have to remain as point sources. Okay? Now, I told you that the primary is a massive structure of 100 tons. Now, what happens when the telescope is looking, let us say, at this position? Okay? We know that there is gravity, which is having an effect on all objects, right? So, this gravity will have an effect on each of these segments also. Now, just imagine 30 meter, which is like, you know, a basketball court. Okay, so one end from the center to that is 15 meters. So, you are looking at something which is as big as a basketball court, right? So, how is the gravity going to affect? Naturally, the effect of the gravity is higher on the segment which is at the end as compared to something which is closer to the structure, the center of the structure, okay, which is nothing but the center of gravity of this entire system. So, what happens because of that, the distortion will be caused. What does gravity do? It tends to bring it slightly lower. So, there is distortion caused. So, your star which is a point source will no longer remain a point source. It will become elongated or it may get some other funny shape, right? So, what needs to be done is, we have a control system which is what is called as the M1 control system. This is what helps in maintaining the overall shape of the primary against effects of gravity. Temperature can also cause slight differences. The change in the temperature across the mirror from one end to another can cause considerable amount of difference. Because here we are talking of extremely sharp images, okay? All these parameters are very critical because we are talking of extremely sharp images. So, what is done here is that now you have to take care of the sag, let us say, due to the gravity. Now, if all of them are touching each other, then you cannot do that. You may end up rubbing against the edges. So, you are damaging the mirror, right? You don't want to do that. So, that's the reason why this gap is given. And this is the bare minimum that you can keep for to not lose too much of light, to have your collecting area as you desire, that is 30 meter. Plus, this is the minimum gap required so that the segments don't go and touch each other at any given position because of all these effects. Segment exchange is basically these segments are, the reflecting surface. No, there are six sectors, each with 82 segment, right? So, 492 segments plus one spare for each type. So, you may need to re-aluminize these segments, which will keep happening. So, it is a physical exchange of the segment. So, when you remove one segment out to re-aluminize, you replace it with the spare so that you are not left with a gaping hole in that portion. So, that is a segment exchange. Yeah, so basically this M1 control system, it controls the global shape of the mirror, and this is done by using edge sensors and actuators which are mounted on each segment. So, each segment has, three pairs of edge sensors and three actuators and each segment is supported on its own segment support assembly, and all these 492 segments with multiplied by 3 actuators, multiplied by 6 edge sensors, they all have to behave to keep this massive thing as a single 30 meter mirror of the given meniscus, desired meniscus. Okay, so here is an example of the wavefront change. I mean, these different colors here indicate, you know, the difference in the image quality that you would get because of the warping due to, for example, the wind, you know, the surface error due to the disturbances in the wind pattern. So here the red, for example, is, you know, those portions are kind of affected and giving minute peaks in the wavefront that you're getting, which means that, you know, the elongation can happen in these directions. Now when we have the control system on, you can see it is a nice, more or less smooth wavefront that you're getting without these peaks and valleys. Okay, the secondary is a 3.1 meter convex hyperboloid. It is interesting that the secondary of this telescope is almost the same size as the largest telescope that we recently installed in the country, in Devasthal. It's close to Nainital. So you can, you know, by this you can gather where India stands today in the current scenario. So it, for us, it's a real huge leap from the 2 to 3 meter class telescopes to a 30 meter telescope. It's, you know, as we have been saying, it's one TMT to another TMT. Yeah, so the tertiary, as I mentioned earlier, it's a flat mirror, and as you can see, this is also a fairly big sized one. It's not full, exactly circular or a rectangle. It's elliptical in shape, and this is basically to take the beam which is coming, and you're getting the light reflected from the secondary, and when you put a 45 degree mirror, the converging beams from the secondary, okay, they'll have a slightly elliptical shape, because this is not exactly at the focus of the secondary, it is slightly ahead of the focus, so it will have an elliptical shape. Now if you have a circular mirror, you would be losing out the light coming from this region, and that's the reason why the tertiary is also elliptical, to take care of all the light and avoid any light loss. This size and shape is such that all the light which is coming from the secondary falls on this. There is no loss, okay? And this entire light is reflected to the Nasmyth focus, to the instrument. So there's no question of the shadow causing any problem. So the tertiary mirror is being developed by China as a part of their in-kind contribution. The telescope structure is being designed by MELCO, that is Japan's contribution, and one of Japan's contribution. The instruments itself, based on the science cases, the detailed science cases, the science advisory committee of the project studied various instruments that can deliver most of the required science. And after numerous meetings, choice of the first three initial instruments has been made. These are the three instruments which will be available at first light. These are two instruments which will operate in the near infrared, that is 0.9 to 2.5 micron. And one instrument which will operate in the optical region, which is from 0.3 to about 1 micron. And there is a suite of future generation instruments also sort of kept in mind because of the science cases. And these will include high resolution spectrographs in both the optical and infrared region, instruments to observe in the mid-infrared, that is all the way from 3 micron to about 28 micron. It will have different instruments. And also a future upgrade of the adaptive optics system, which will help us achieve the diffraction limit of the telescope. Okay. At first light, there will be an initial adaptive optic system available, but that will not help us achieve the diffraction limit. A future upgrade is what will help us achieve the diffraction limit. So this is an azimuth configuration where the instruments are mounted, and these are, this is the instrument suite, the first decade instrument. This one nefarious, this is the adaptive optic system. And at the focal plane of the nefarious will be, this is the first light instrument, and another first light instrument which is going to be mounted here. This is the first optical instrument which is seeing limited, which will come at first light, and then the future instruments are just given as an illustration. Now here is a full structure of the telescope, an artist's conception of how it will look, the entire structure with the various axes and the bearing positions, the alignment and phasing system is here, the different instruments, the secondary, the tertiary, the laser launch system to create artificial stars for adaptive optics, and so this is the pier of the telescope. So this is how it looks if you were to go into the observing floor of the telescope. Okay, now this entire structure will be housed inside a dome, and the enclosure is a Calouette design. This design was arrived at after various simulations of the movement of the wind. Now the it's extremely important to carefully design the dome, because any structure that you build around the telescope can change the wind flow, as a result of which you would be causing some turbulence. Now this turbulence will happen very close to the mirror, and you don't want to introduce additional turbulence and spoil the seeing. So the dome itself has to be extremely carefully designed. As is seen in this representation here, the dome has several vents. Now this is to ensure a free flow of the wind through the vents, which will enable maintaining the temperature of the mirror to the ambient temperature. And the dome is being built by Canada as a part of its in-kind contribution. The building itself will have various other facilities. The most important of this facility is having the vacuum coating plants, that is chambers where the mirrors are going to be aluminized, or on which the reflective coating is going to be deposited. There are two different chambers, one for the primary mirror segment. The chamber is being designed such that at any given point of time you can coat three segments at a given time, and there will be a second chamber for coating the primary, the secondary and the tertiary mirrors. So let me come to our participation in this project. Who are the participants from India? The PI institutes, the main institutes responsible for executing this project in India, are ARIES in Nainital, that's the Aryabhatta Research Institute for Astronomy and Earth Sciences. Yeah. IAE, which is the Indian Institute of Astrophysics, and IUCA, which is the Indian University Center for Astronomy and Astrophysics. The DST has formed an India TMT Coordination Center, for which IAE is a nodal institute. And the principal investigators are the directors of IAE, IUCA, and ARIES. TIFR Mumbai is also a partner institute from India. The program director is from IAE, Ishu Reddy. We have an associate program director who is Ramaprakash from IUCA. And there are several key members, and in addition to these people who are very closely involved in the execution of this project, there are about 20 astronomers from various institutes and universities who are all members of the science development teams. So the project is just about beginning to mature now, and we are increasing the number of people who are involved in this project. Just to give you a quick background of how we arrived at where we are today, it all started in 2007 when we were approached by the three projects looking for a possible partnership from India. And there were a series of national level meetings following which it was decided that India will join the 30 meter telescope project. The main driver for India's participation in this 30 meter telescope project is the fact that this project allows up to 70% in-kind contribution, so which essentially means that 70% of the amount that we are going to spend on this project from within India, that is 70% of our 10% contribution, is going to be spent in the country. Okay? And not only is it going to be spent in the country, we have the major advantage of technology being brought into the country, a technology which otherwise you cannot get, we are getting by being partners in this. As I mentioned earlier, India joined the project at a full, as a full partner at 10% partnership in December last year. So what is our role in the project? There's six major areas, all of them related with technology associated with the primary mirror. We will be polishing a portion of the M1 segments, about 90 segments will be polished in India. We are also responsible for the delivery of all the actuators, all the edge sensors for all the segments plus the spare. Okay. As I said, there are three actuators and six pairs of edge sensors. So we are also responsible for the delivery of all the segment support assemblies, that is 492 plus 82 spares. For the M1 controls, the electronics of these M1 control system. So essentially we will be getting the technology for developing a segmented mirror telescope in the country. So this was a major attraction for us to participate in this project. We're also responsible, partly responsible for the telescope control software and the observatory control software, for the design and delivery of the coating chambers for all the mirrors. We have been involved in the first light instruments and obviously the science requirements that follow. First light is when you first look up to the sky and obtain light. So the telescope will go to first light, will be commissioned along with three instruments. So we are also considering, we are talking to the project, and maybe at a later point of time we would like to host the TMT Science Center and the remote observing facility in the country. So these are the work packages related to M1 and M1 control systems. About 90 segments, the edge sensors which are here, the segment support assembly which is this unit, and the actuators. Okay, so all of them is something that we need to deliver, and the related electronics. These smaller ones, this is a segment support assembly, so each segment has its own support assembly. And this consists of several, you know, almost about some 200 different parts, will all be made here and assembled. And the integrated system will have the segment mounted on it and be delivered to the project. So the polishing itself, the project has come up with a two-stage parallelized production for the segments. The stage one will be polishing the mirrors. It will be done in four different, amongst four partners. In the US and Japan will be doing a majority of the mirrors. China and what type each one of us will be doing is currently, you know, not very well determined. It is all determined on, you know, how well versed we are and what is the state of our you know, expertise in doing it. Okay, so China and India will be doing about 15%, the rest will be done by Japan and US. We'll all be polishing this to an intermediary level, which is looking at the errors, the surface errors, to better than 2 micron peak to valley kind of error. That is a surface finish we'll be doing. And all the mirrors will be mounted on the individual segment support assembly and sent to the US, where the final figuring will be done in one location. And from there, it will go to the site for aluminizing and integration. Okay. So for the segment polishing facility in India, we will be collaborating with an industrial partner who is already qualified to polish the segments. The facility will be coming up in our campus at Hoskote. Now, this partnership includes training and the equipment build at the vendor's work, as well as, you know, subsequent to the installation at our facility, after an initial low rate of production, it will be ramped up. So essentially, we should be delivering our share of the polished mirrors sometime by the end of 2019 or mid of 2018 or something like that. So the as I mentioned, the production steps will be we will be grinding and polishing using the method called the stress mirror polishing method. And then the polishing is actually done on a roundel. That is, the blanks are round in shape. So these blanks are slightly larger than the required hexagonal shape. They're 1.52 meters. And the polishing will be done on those. And after they are polished to the required surface accuracy, they have to be cut into the desired hexagonal shape. And the hex cut mirrors will be integrated with their individual segment support assembly, then inspected and sent for the final figuring. Final figuring is done with the segment mounted on its support assembly, and the coating is also done with the mirror mounted on its support assembly. So the segment support assembly, this is a system which basically provides the passive support in in a three plane degree of freedom. And it also permits that is the piston and tip tilt controls, and helps in maintaining the periodic correction, the shape correction of the segment. Currently we are producing prototypes of these systems. It is being done by at Godrej in Mumbai and by Asarala Technologies at Bangalore. These are the two companies which are producing the prototypes. So here is just an example of the various activities which go into the segment polishing. After the roundel has been polished, one has to make a central hole. It's a central diaphragm, which is only at the back portion of the mirror, which is going to be integrated with the segment support assembly. Now, this is just an illustration of the hexagon shape being made. Now, these are the pockets where the edge sensor will be mated to the back of the mirror. So here's the figure showing the support segment support assembly being integrated with the prototype mirror, gone for iron beam figuring, and the final finished segment mounted on its support. This was done on a prototype in the US, not here. So this is a closer view of the segment, the polished segment, a closer view of the support assembly. As you can see, it's a fairly complicated system with several parts all integrated together, and you can see some of these wirings for all the electronics here. So this is again another view. Now the mirror itself is mated with this support assembly through these invar rods, which are bonded to the back of the polished mirror. And here is a full-scale segment and its support assembly, the prototype, which was displayed at the TMT booth in the SPIE conference, which was held in Montreal last year. So coming to the primary mirror control system, this is being done partly in the US and in India. JPL has come up with the design, and India has been developing the prototype currently, and then it will also be producing all these systems. Here is an example. I mean, these are pictures of the actuators and the edge sensors which were made, the prototypes which were made in India. So these are again some pictures of people involved, and these are the actual prototypes which were developed by Asarala Technologies. So this, the actuators delivered by Asarala are undergoing a lot of functional and performance tests and are found to work satisfactory. And just as a risk mitigation, we are also under the process of identifying a second vendor. The edge sensors were made in General Optics Asia Limited in Pondicherry. The prototypes have been delivered and found to be satisfactory. There are additional tests which are going on currently to understand or rather develop alternate coating process. These edge sensors are basically glass, of the shape, made of zero-door glass, that is low expansion glass, and they're also highly polished surfaces on which you have gold coating, okay? So it is extremely important to develop a coating process which will retain the coating even when in use for whatever, some 30 years of the lifetime of the telescope, okay? This is again some pictures of the, and here is again a picture of what the mirror and its controls, M1 control system, will finally look like. So it is 492 of these systems which will go and form the primary mirror. In addition, there are also some activities happening at our lab in IIA, and we have actually developed a test station to test the function of the actuators, and we are also devising methods to calibrate the edge sensors, calibrate and test them, which is extremely useful during the production for the, you know, the quality control of the products which are being produced. Coming to the software, as I said, the observatory control software will be done by India. Part of the telescope control software is also India's responsibility. There are other requirements in the software which will be done in the US, and maybe in the future we'll have the data management system also. But some amount of data management system as required by these systems will also be developed by us. So here are some pictures of the software group in action. Now here is a prototyping of the observatory software, which was done by a company in Pune. So this is just to visualize the field of view that one would get, and to be able to identify and the objects that we observe. Coming to the science and instruments, at IIA we recently concluded the study of the polarimetric budget, the instrumental polarization caused by the telescope optics, which is an important factor to understand, because the polarization of the light can also have an effect on the point spread function that you get from the telescope. We also devised a method to generate a guide star catalog, which will be very useful when you actually do the observations. And India is also involved in the design of the first light instruments. Recently we concluded about 6 mini studies related to different areas of the design of the first light instrument, which is going to operate in the optical range. So this is just an example. I mean, the guide star catalog has been published, and this has been an extremely successful effort, and the next step will be to actually use the data that one obtains from large surveys. So basically, I mean, this summarizes about the telescope and what India is doing. So this picture here shows you the various telescopes in the past. The present 10 meter class telescopes are here. This here, these here, and in the future we'll be having these three large telescopes and the Large Synoptic Survey Telescope and the James Webb Telescope. So in the 2020s, this is what the future of telescopes will look like. Some acknowledgements and credits. Thank you.
So we thank Professor Anupama for giving us not just a bird's eye view of the 30 meter telescope, but getting into the finer aspects of the project, the science, the instrumentation, and how the overall project is going to be implemented. So it was a very good presentation. Thank you very much, Professor Anupama. And so we thank you all for making it very interactive as usual. And that actually sparks up the whole presentation.